Isn't there so much faith in that song? Like, I'm just watching your faith rise as you're singing that. And let me just pray for a second, Lord Jesus. Oh, we're grateful that you can turn graves into gardens. We're grateful that seas can become highways, that transformation is possible because you are greater than any problem. You are greater than any crisis. You are greater than any mountain in front of us. All things bow at the name of Jesus, and you can transform all things for your good. So we're grateful to be in your presence, and we ask you to transform us. Lord, lead us now. Everybody say, my heart's open. My mind's ready. Make me better, God. Transform me with your word. I'm ready. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Why don't you air high five somebody, and you can be seated. Air high five, don't real high five them. You know, it's against the law right now. If you have a Bible, go to Acts chapter 12. We're talking about uncaged prayer today. Everybody say uncaged prayer. Come on, say it again, say uncaged prayer. So we've been working our way through the book of Acts, and we are in Acts 12. Last week we were in Acts 10, and we talked about God's conversation about diversity, and we talked about how all the races are equal and why that is the case, and how God broke through the mindset of racism of the Jewish nation and said, we gotta reach all people with the gospel, and like that's where we went last week. Today, the chapter we're in, Acts 12, is on prayer, and you'll notice on the note sheet, if you have a note sheet, grab that. And we're gonna get there in a minute. Like you can also look this up on your phone. Like you can go to Acts, just go to Google and go Acts 12, New King James Version, and you can read along on your own phone. But I wanna give you a couple quotes as kind of like you're getting situated with either a Bible or a phone or the note sheet or all that kind of stuff. Just gonna give you a couple quotes on prayer just to kind of get us going. The man who mobilizes the Christian church to pray will make the greatest contribution to world evangelism in history. Second quote, this is Samuel Chadwick in The Path of Prayer. The one concern of the devil is to keep the saints from prayer. The one thing he's trying to do is keep you from praying. Our enemy fears nothing from prayerless studies, prayerless work, prayerless religion. He laughs at our toil. He mocks at our wisdom, but trembles when we pray. Prayer turns ordinary mortals into men of power. It brings fire, it brings rain, it brings life, it brings God. There is no power like the power of prevailing prayer. Now, what was interesting is, I don't know if you have recognized this, but your country seems to be in crisis right now. Did you notice? Yes, you didn't notice. Okay, maybe you just haven't turned the news on in like 6 months and you don't know. But like, it seems like the country's kind of in crisis. Actually, the world is in crisis. We got health issues going on, obviously, but then we've got racial tension going on. And like, we've just got so much stuff that the country is dealing with right now. I feel like I'm just being honest. In my entire lifetime, I have never seen our country in as much crisis as it is right now. When you take the racial tension, the economic struggle, and the health issue all combined into one, I remember the first Gulf War. I remember when the wall came down in Russia. I can remember, obviously, the Iraq War. I remember Afghanistan. I remember all of that stuff. But I can't remember, at least in my lifetime, anything that seemed more of a crisis than what we're facing now. And the reason is because it's not just over there, it's affecting you. It's affecting me. It's like, it's affecting our businesses. It's affecting churches. It's affecting communities. The things that normally would be like going on, none of that stuff is going on. And so we are in the middle, in my estimation, we are in the middle of the biggest crisis our country has ever faced personally. And having said that, I thought it was kind of fascinating. I looked online to see, well, I wonder how Americans are dealing, or Christians in particular, are dealing with the crisis. And they did some research on Christianity, and they said, how have you best tried to deal with this crisis? The number one answer from Christians, not kidding you, watch Netflix. You know the second greatest answer? Go camping. But you know what you couldn't find on the list until way, way, way down was prayer. You couldn't find people going, oh my gosh, this is a pretty significant deal. Trillions of dollars gone, like economies falling apart. Like we're in a desperate situation with health issues and with crisis in homes. And like there's so much going on, but you couldn't find on the list among lost people, but among Christians, you couldn't hardly find prayer as the way in which I'm dealing with this struggle. And that kind of like, stunned me for a second. But then if I was really honest about it, I don't I don't naturally go to prayer with my crises either. I'm just being honest about who I am as a person. I have, so there was this time I said this bad word in front of my family. And it's a word pastors shouldn't say, actually church people shouldn't say at all. So Holland was about 8, so we got 3 little kids, and so maybe Braden is 12 or something, 13 maybe. And we had decided to take a family trip to go see Kelly's parents. At the time, they were living in Illinois. They were working at a camp called Great Oaks Camp, and it was a Christian camp, and they were serving there. And we're like, well, let's go visit them. So it was like end of March, beginning of April, so the snow wasn't quite gone, but it was warm. We're like, oh, this is gonna be awesome. So we packed up the minivan. Yes, we had a minivan. It sucked. I had one for 12 years. If you have one, I'm sorry. I'm just joking with you. So anyway, we had this minivan that we thought was really cool at the time, and we couldn't pack everything in it, so we rented a little U-Haul trailer to pack all the stuff, because we got 3 kids on vacation. So we rented this little U-Haul trailer, and we put everything in it. Once we got the trailer, we're like, dude, we can put bikes in here. So we put bikes in there, and like all kinds of stuff. We packed this thing full to the brim, because we're going on a 10-day vacation. This is going to be awesome. So we get the minivan, and we got the trailer, and I don't know if you know this or not, but minivans should not pull heavy things. Well, we drive the 8 or 9 hours to Illinois to get to her parents' house, and there's more snow like than we thought, and we kind of come like, and it's out in the country, and there's gravel and snow, and I come around this corner. We're all like 2 miles from her parents' house, and I went around this corner, and I remember feeling the back end just swing, and all of that weight just hammers the ditch, and I'm like, no, we're only 2 miles from this whole thing, and we could be there. And now the back end's in this whole trailer's in the snow, buried in the ditch, and I'm like, and so I get out, and I look, and you know how you're like trying to figure out what to do? I said, should I dig it out? And so you kind of dig out some of the wheel wells, and you're kind of doing the thing, and I'm like, all right, Kelly, you get behind the driver's seat, and I'm gonna get behind, and we're gonna push. And so kids are all inside, they're just watching out the windows, and I'm pushing, and she's hammering on this thing, and it's, of course, it ain't moving, because minivans aren't made for that. And so I'm getting frustrated, and I walk around again, and I do a little more digging. We try again, and I push, and nothing happens, and finally I remember she got back around to the passenger side, and she got back in, and so I walked over, and I get in the driver's side, and I slam the door, and out popped a word that pastors shouldn't say. And the whole van got real quiet. It was like, Dad's mad. Nobody say anything. And it got real quiet, and I'm sitting there, and I'm like, so close. And then from the peanut gallery in the very back row, my daughter goes, well, Daddy, don't you think we could pray about it? But what did I taught her? I taught her in crisis, we pray. But what I showed her was in crisis, we freak out. And so her little voice from the back seat was like the Holy Spirit in the moment. And I was like, yeah, we should probably pray. And so I turned toward Kelly and she turned toward me, and the little kids came, kind of got together, and we prayed. God, can you please get us out of this ditch? I don't know how to get out of this ditch. And it wasn't like a long prayer. It was just a couple minutes. Let's just pray. And then I got back out, and I think Braden got up, got out with me, and we both are behind this van pushing, and Kelly gets behind the driver's seat, and she just hits the gas, and we just drove right out of this ditch. I don't know if there was like an angel that was pushing that was suddenly like came and joined us in the pushing, but there must be an angel of car problems or something. Because after we prayed, we just drove right out of this ditch. And then I was like, thanks, Holland, that was good. And we kind of went about our way. And I have never forgotten that situation, because I feel like if I would remember to pray in my crisis, I would more likely have better outcomes. But what we tend to do when we hit our crisis is, I don't know, things crazy, let's watch some Netflix. I don't know, let's go camping, And we forget, if you want the economy to go better, maybe we better hit our knees. If you want people to work and have incomes, if you want health problems to go away, if you want to see racial tensions gone, maybe the church should rise up in this season and actually begin to pray again. Not just go to church, Not just show up, nothing wrong with, I'm glad you're here. Dude, I think this is, like, I looked around the room, I think we have like 3 spots available right now for space. We're probably gonna go back to 3 services in Elk River soon because we gotta make sure we keep spreading people out. So we'll probably go back to 3. But I'm so excited about that. Keep coming to church. But if we're coming to church, but we forget to pray, the ritual doesn't transform the world. It is prayer that does. It is prayer that does. And that's what Acts chapter 12 is about. Acts chapter 12 is about a church in crisis. This early church had gone through all this racial tension and they had figured all this kind of stuff out. And then in Acts chapter 12, the government goes a little nuts. Ever feel like that about your government? I'll say that in an honorable way. You know, they just feel like they're just not quite in touch all the time. And the government goes a little nuts, and they don't just go a little nuts, they kill James. Like, you know, Jesus' best friend, Peter, James, and John, they kill James. Then they arrest Peter. And now the church is in massive crisis. And I want you to see how the church responds. And here's where we're going to go. We're going to go to Acts 12. And I want you to see how people of faith respond to crisis. And you won't find Netflix in here. And you won't find just go camping. And you won't find just hang out as a family. You'll find things like prayer. Check it out. Acts 12:1. Now, about that time, Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some from the church, and when he had killed James, the brother of John, with the sword, and because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also, and now it was during the days of the unleavened bread, and so when he had arrested him, he put him into prison and delivered him to 4 squads of soldiers to keep him. A squad of soldiers in the Roman Empire was four men, so that's 16 soldiers that are now guarding Peter in this prison to keep him, intending to bring him out before the people after Passover. So you've got a crazy king killing people and throwing Peter, Jesus' best friend, in prison. Everybody say crisis. Now, I want you to think about this crisis in 2 ways. I want you to think about it in terms of human and demonic. Everybody say human and demonic. Do you realize that every crisis you face, whenever you are opposed by another person, there's a human element to it, because you got a crazy king. That was human. There was government tyranny going on. That was human. But I want you to understand that behind the scenes, there is a demonic entity influencing that decision to kill James and put Peter in prison. I want you to understand that you don't face opposition in just the human realm, you also face it in the spiritual realm. And if you would remember that, it'd be much easier to forgive people that hurt you. Why? Because check this verse out, this is awesome. This is Ephesians 6 verse 12, it says, "We do not wrestle against flesh and blood." You're not fighting human people even when they're against you. Well, who am I fighting? But against principalities and powers and rulers of the darkness of this age and against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. He just listed different levels of demonic activity. When you feel like your government is moving in a direction that's not healthy and it's oppressing you, there's a demonic being behind it. When there's a person in the workplace that just keeps coming after you, there's a demonic being behind it. By the way, when people make fun of me, this is how I deal with it then. So the people will mock me or come after me or whatever, and I kind of go, "Aw, I'm sorry, so they're so gullible that they get influenced by the demonic." And that's really the truth. It's a lot easier to forgive somebody who's gullible. "Oh, they just don't really know any better." And it's a whole lot easier to forget because they're not the problem. That person who's attacking you is not the problem. It's the demonic being behind it that's the problem. And so rather than being angry at this person, they're just kind of dumb. They just don't really know any better. So easy to forget because they're not the problem. It's the demonic force behind the scenes that's the problem. Most, all of the opposition we face in the life is both human and demonic. So then think about crisis for a second. Think about our country in crisis right now. I just wrote a bunch of stuff down. We have racial conflict going on that is both human and demonic. Racism is a demonic problem, not just a human issue. Don't just be mad at the KKK. How about we be like, "Dude, they're being influenced by something really horrible. Let's pray that the demonic entities there are bound and banished and gone, and those people will repent and turn to God and turn to faith." And yeah. Government overreach and tyranny. I am very concerned in this season of government overreach and tyranny. I get nervous when a government tells us what we have to wear. That makes me nervous. But then I want to back up for a second and say, every government is influenced by a demonic entity. If you read the book of, if you read the book of Daniel, it talks about that every major world power has a demonic being assigned to it. And it's fascinating how in this whole process of the last 6 months, you have watched every government do the same thing. It's like they're all, like there's something going on. Like, why can't they, what's going on here? There's something both human and demonic going on in the governments of the world. It's not just a human problem that we are dealing with. And then on top of that, we do have some real health issues, and that's physical. But remember that the enemy came to steal, kill, and destroy. He's so excited that more people can get sick. And an election nearing and chaos for voting and schools restarting and you trying to figure out how do I get my kids to school or not go to school or this what's this issue and then what's that issue? Like the government, like I want you to know the enemy is always seeking to sow confusion. The more confusion he sows in a culture, the more fear and more anxiety, the more anger rises up. And the more he can just sow some confusion, the more we get tension in the world. It is a demonic thing going on in our nation. Somebody said to me last night that they had a friend that just flew in from India, and they were missionaries in India, and they came here, and they were like, what is going, they hadn't been in America in a couple years. They were like, what is going on with the oppression here? I have never felt so much spiritual oppression in America before. Remember, you're in it, so you're kind of like the frog in the kettle, and it just kind of gets hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter, and you don't really notice. But when somebody else comes into it, they're like, whoa, what is going on? I want you to understand that your country, your world right now, it is thick with demonic oppression. We are facing something really sinister in our world behind the scenes. This economic disaster, the enemy wants to make sure that people don't eat, that businesses close. Why? Because the more negative that can happen, the more anger will rise and the more anxiety will rise and the more frustration will rise and the more chaos will rise. The situation in Acts 12 with a demonic king or a king that was demonically influenced but human is not any different than the situation we face today. We are in a situation with a human government that is influenced by another world, another realm. That should drive us to pray. Oh, what did I tell you? Like, let me just back up for a second. What did I tell you I did when the van and the trailer went in the ditch? Oh yeah, I just swore about it. Doesn't it seem like what Christians are doing is just getting on Facebook and spouting off about it? Rather than, I'm just asking, don't stone me. I want you to understand you are adding to the anxiety. You're adding to the tension. You're adding to the anger. See, the way in which problems are solved, the way in which Christian people handle crisis is prayer. That we hit our knees and say, God, you gotta do something because this is crazy and above my pay grade and I can't fix it. So I'm not gonna vent about it and I'm not gonna swear about it and I'm not gonna get angry about it. I'm gonna ask you, the great healer and transformer, to please fix this because nobody else can. This has to be what we turn to. Because anything else is just going to cause more problems and the devil gets a victory. Right. On top of this, I keep hearing of families that are dealing with conversations about divorce and the family's in crisis now, emotional tension and relational and economic pressure. And then you think about our church in the middle of all this crisis, we're trying to still reach people with the gospel. And we did baptize 110 people, and we are still trying to start more churches, but we're also trying to keep all these little baby churches alive that we can't even find where people disappeared to, being closed for 4 or 5 months. I mean, St. Paul's still not open at all because they still can't have more than 10 people gathered. That beautiful new church that had just been off the ground for a year and 100 to 125 people a week going to worship. Nobody knows where they went. See, the only way we're gonna, let's just look at the next verse. Like, let's go back to the text. Let's go back to Acts 12. So you got a crisis, and this is the next verse in this text. So Peter was therefore kept in prison. But what's the next two words? What's those two words? Constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. And I'm just going to stop for a second. They didn't know if Peter was going to live or die. James had already been killed. Don't you think they probably prayed for James too? They were like, well, James is in jail. Let's go watch Netflix. We should go camping because I don't know what else to do. So James is in jail. Let's go camping. No, they probably prayed for James too, but God allowed him to still be executed. So now Peter's in jail and they're like, we don't know what else to do. We have no other thing that we know to do except to pray. And they're, come on, God, you got to do a miracle here. Like, I'm trusting you to do a miracle. If you don't, we'll trust you. But please, can you please rescue Peter from this prison? We need him. The response to the crisis from the early church was extraordinary prayer. Now, what I didn't say was the response to the crisis was, you know, let's just get together every so often and be like, good Lord, good meat, good bread, let's eat. Now I lay me down to sleep, I pray my Lord my soul to keep, if I should not. I'm talking real prayer. Real communication with the Father in which, like, you and a group of people, you hit your knees and you're like, God, we got to see something transform. We got to see something change. This cannot be the future of this nation. This cannot be the future of our country. This cannot be the future of my family. You've got to do a miracle here. We need something to happen. I found this quote by a guy named John Piper. He's way smarter than I am. Here's what he says. He says, prayer is primarily a wartime walkie-talkie for the mission of the church as it advances against the powers of darkness and unbelief. It is not surprising that prayer malfunctions when we try to use it as a domestic intercom to call upstairs for more comforts in the den. Until you know that life is war, come on, say life is war. You cannot know what prayer is for. Prayer is for the accomplishment of a wartime mission. Guys, you are not on a playground. You are in a battlefield, and the enemy would love to destroy you, your family, and your nation. So the only answer to this is call out an airstrike. You get on your knees, and you pray, and you beg God to move. You ask God to come to intervene. You ask God's transformation power on this world, on this nation, on our government, on all things. Why? Because if we pray, God might move. This hit me so hard this week that I went and looked. I just happened to look up when Labor Day was, which is 21 days from tomorrow. And so I wrote you a little 21-day extraordinary prayer guide. Can you get that out for a second? So the season we are in as a nation and as families is such that we need to begin to be focused in our prayer life to see God move. And so each day for the next 21 days, starting tomorrow, we'd like you to read the verses that we provided and then spend a focused time praying for the prayer requests below. I don't want you to just come to worship and study prayer. I want you to begin to pray. Now, there are three elements to this focused prayer time. Week one, we're going to pray for our country. If I forgot something on this list of things, we're week one, starting tomorrow, we are praying for our nation. Week two, we are praying for our families and our personal lives. God, hold it together during this season. And then the third week, we're going to pray for our church and its mission. Why? Because we are in crisis. And we keep denying it by going, okay, I'm just going to waste some more time. No, crisis is only going to get averted as we begin to pray. So tomorrow, like just tomorrow morning, we're going to pray for our country. So August 17th, I want you to get up in the morning. By the way, we'll post this online as well. I want you to read Isaiah 26, verse 3 tomorrow morning. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. God, we believe that you are the only one that can give us perfect peace, so we are seeking you right now, and specifically we seek you for racial reconciliation. We pray that the races would learn to love each other, that it would start with us, that we would be the people of humility necessary to cause racial reconciliation to occur. You start with us. And that's our prayer tomorrow. And the next day, we're going to pray for our government. We're going to pray about overreach and about trampling of rights. And why? Because there's a demonic entity behind all this stuff that's seeking to rule and reign. And the only way we kick back the gates of hell is prayer. So for 21 days, we want you to pray like the early church prays. Every day, on your knees, for a couple minutes, God, you move, God, you transform, God, you do a work. It's the only thing that's gonna save this nation and save our families and save our church. It's the only thing that's gonna do it. Now, we'll keep reading. Here's what it says next, and we'll just keep going. So I'm gonna read you the rest of the story. So you've got a crisis, you've got prayer, and then here's the entire rest of the story. I'm just gonna read through the rest of it, and I'm gonna make some comments at the end. And when Herod was about to bring him out, that night, Peter was sleeping, we're gonna come back to that, bound between two chains, between two soldiers, and the guards before the door were keeping the prison. Now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison cell, and he struck Peter on the side. He had to wake him up by hitting him, which I think is awesome. He was that in deep asleep. And he raised him up and said, "Arise quickly." And immediately his chains fell off his hands. He didn't have to work to free himself. He was just freed. God can do that. Then the angel said to him, "Gird yourself and tie on your sandals." And he did so. And he said to him, "Put on your garment and follow me." And so he went out and followed him and did not know that what was being done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. And I want you to know, I just thought about this for a second. I was reading this the first time. I was like, huh, if this was a vision, it was like the worst vision ever. He's in jail. I have a vision of escaping. And then he wakes up, I'm still in jail. Worst vision ever. Anyhow, it's actually legit. And he's leaving this jail cell. And when they had passed the first and the second guard post, they came to the iron gate that led to the city, which opened to them of its own accord. And in the Greek word there is automate. It's like when you go to Cub and the slider's open. So what happens to the iron gate? It's the first automatic door in the history of the world. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the Jewish people." So when he had considered this, so now he's free. He went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. So they're still praying. I want you to think about this for a second. They were still praying and the miracle had already happened. So when the words leave your lips, it's not that God will do something. God is already doing something before the prayer is over. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a girl named Rhoda came to answer, and when she recognized Peter's voice, because of her gladness, she did not open the door, but ran back inside and announced that Peter come to the gate. He's like, "Knock, knock. Peter! You wanna open the door for me?" "No, all right. So then he goes back to knocking. But they said to her, "You are beside yourself." Note, I can't help but throw this out there too. So when, notice that they are praying, but they are doubting also. I want you to understand that you and I are always a mixture of doubt and faith. People always look at me and they're like, "Well, you don't have doubt, Pastor." I want you to know, I do. I'm always shouting down my doubt and speaking faith. I am not gonna give in to doubt. I'm not gonna give in to fear. I'm not gonna give in to anxiety. I'm gonna shout down the fear. I'm gonna shout down the anxiety. I'm gonna speak faith in the middle of this. Because we are always this mixture. There's always a war going on inside of each of us over this doubt and this fear. And so even them, they were like, it's not true. There's nothing going on. So they said it must be his angel. Now Peter continued knocking. When they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. But motioning to them with his hand to keep silent, he declared to them how the Lord had brought him out of prison. Dude, it was awesome. And the door, there was an automated door and chains fell off. And there was an angel and lights. And it was so cool. And he's like telling this whole story and he's kind of freaking out. And he says to them, "Now go and tell these things to James," which is a different James, "and to the brethren." And then he departed and went to another place. And here's how I want to kind of wrap up this whole story today. I want to tell you three things that happened to them as they prayed, and then we'll be done. First is supernatural peace. Come on, say supernatural peace. I want to ask you the question, as they were praying, what was Peter doing? What was he doing? He was so at rest with God. He was going to be killed the next day. If you were going to be killed the next day by beheading, would you be asleep the night before? It'd be tough. He'd be like pacing back and forth. "They're going to chop my head off tomorrow. I don't know what I'm going to do. Oh God, you got to fix this. I can't believe I'm dealing with this." Like I know how I would be. And he has so given his crisis to God that he sleeps. I want you to know that if you will give your crisis to God, you can rest. supernatural peace. God, I don't know what I'm going to do about my job. I don't know what I'm going to do about my business. I don't know what I'm going to do about this health issue. I don't know what I'm going to do about this thing. But you said if I cast my care on you, you're going to take good care of it. So I take it off of me. I take this burden off of me, and I place it on you. And if I can give this burden to you, I know that I can be okay. Now, I'm going to give you the two verses. We read one of them a second ago, and I'm going to give it to you again because it's so powerful. This is Isaiah 26:3. We read it a minute ago. It says this. You will keep him in, what's the next two words? Perfect peace. In the Hebrew, it's double peace. Everybody say double peace. And the way it's used in the Hebrew is it's peace to the full, 100% peace times two. Like the max peace you could ever have in your life multiplied by two, which is absolutely beyond comprehension. That's how much peaceful God will give you. So he says, you will give him perfect peace, double peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. And I have to make this statement. I want you to understand that prayer is not about you getting what you want all the time. Prayer is first and foremost about you giving, being given peace to handle the circumstances that you face. So why pray? Because God's gonna move. But as you pray, God starts to stir in your heart. He starts to move in you. And rather than just wanting what you want, suddenly you are okay with whatever God wants. I'm gonna be okay, God. I don't gotta stress about it. You're gonna take good care of me and my family and the situation. And I gave it to you, and I don't know why, but I'm just not worried anymore. I'm not freaking out any longer. I think I'm gonna go take a nap. Double peace. See, prayer doesn't just change a situation. It changes your own heart first to be able to handle whatever God's about to do next. Come on, say it again, double peace. Now, this is Philippians, this is the New Testament, that was the Old Testament. This is Philippians chapter 4, it says this, be anxious for nothing. Anxiety is always from the enemy. I want you to understand that when you are anxious and nervous, it is always a demonic attack, trying to get you to freak out in the middle of a situation or a struggle. Be anxious for nothing, nothing, never fearing, never afraid, never worried, never stressed, never from God. Oh, I feel better when I'm stressed. No, you're not better stressed. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, you present your requests to God, and what's the next three words? What are the words? And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts. It's beyond comprehension, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. I always have this image of little tin soldiers now guarding my mind. And they're all around my brain. And as I give this request to God, and I give this need to God, and I give this stress to God, it's like he sets up. All these little toy soldiers are like standing around my brain. And every time the enemy tries to throw in an anxious thought, and the enemy's getting kicked away by these angelic soldiers guarding my mind, so that I can be at peace no matter what is happening. In Christianity, your ability to have peace comes from first your ability to pray. Come on, say double peace. Double peace. Secondarily, so first they had double peace, Peter's sleeping. Secondarily, let's talk about there was supernatural activity going on for a second. Everybody say supernatural activity. So I wrote down what happened in the passage. An angel showed up, and chains fell off miraculously, and doors opened by themselves, and prisoners were set free, and there's no logical explanation for that happening at all. It was suddenly, as people prayed, something supernatural occurred. And an angel suddenly pushed the back of the van with all that stuff in the U-Haul back onto the, and I don't have any explanation for it. So, we have some friends that are missionaries. They're here today. Sam and Angie Platt. And they stayed at our farm in Iowa because they needed a place to stay. So they stayed there for like a week or two or whatever. And this farm we have in Iowa, we're only there once a week. So we have this stove at the farm that it always smells like gas. And so when we arrive at the farm, we turn the gas on and then we use the stove for 2 days. And then, or actually we cook a meal and we turn it right back off because we're just afraid we'll blow the whole house up because we always smell in gas. So I called a guy to fix it and he came and I spent a couple $100 and he's like, I think it's fixed. And so then we still smell gas like 2 days later. So then I called a second guy to fix it and we spent a couple $100 and he's like, I think it's fixed. And then two days later smelling gas again. I called three different guys to fix this stupid stove. So finally we just gave up and we're just like, every time we go to the farm, we'll turn the gas on when we cook and we'll turn it back off. So we're sliding the stove out. I got ruts on my linoleum trying to like pull the stove out. It's dumb. So Sam and Angie go to the farm and we're explaining to them, okay, so if you're gonna use the stove, you gotta pull it out first and turn the gas on so you don't blow the house up, cook, and then turn it back off. And they were like, okay. So then we came down to visit them one of the days and we're like, how come the stove is on? And they're like, oh, we just prayed over it. It works fine now. Why didn't I think of that? $600 later. See, I want you to understand that it is not our first thought for something supernatural to occur. So let's pray. Our first thought is, we gotta break Peter out of prison. So grab some swords and let's make a plan and let's play Delta Force. Well, my car's broke, so let's dig into this. I remember Joel Osteen talking one time, they had just done this crusade thing and preached the gospel at this whole thing. And they flew back in and they got off out of their plane and they came down to where their cars were parked. And there's his car and his mom's car. His car started right up and he was gonna leave. And his mom's, she's in her 80s. She comes over to the car and turns it, won't turn over. He's like, It's like, well, mom, why don't you just try with me? She goes, nope. She goes over, she opens up the hood and starts praying over her engine. And she just prays a big old prayer about how this thing's gonna run and it's gonna serve, like work just fine. And like, they just spent like 20 minutes trying to get the thing going and it would not run. And she gets back in the car, turns it right on and drives away. And he's standing there next to it like, what? Our first reaction to every crisis, come on, say first reaction, must become prayer. It's gotta be to pray first, not to shoot the email off, not to pop off at the mouth, not to get on Facebook and vent about this next thing, not to see how I'm gonna fight this or organize that or change that or fix this thing. The first thing we do, we are people of faith. The first thing we do is, God, I believe you do miracles. I believe when I pray, heaven starts to move. I believe when I pray, angels are already moving before the sentence is even over. I believe that heaven waits on my word, that they wanna run to my aid, that they wanna come help and bless and change and transform. And so I'm praying right now knowing that you are moving before I have even finished praying. This has got to be the heart's cry of our lives. Sometimes people are like, well, I don't think Christianity works anymore. I never see miracles. Maybe it's operator problems. It's not that God is not in the business of miracles. It's that when's the last time we really, really said, God, I need you to fix this crisis, because credit cards aren't gonna fix it, an organization isn't gonna fix it, and venting isn't gonna fix it. The only way I know this is ever gonna get fixed is you have to move. So in Jesus' name, by his power, will you come to my aid? Will you come to our country's aid? Will you come to our school's aid or our business aid? I think you can do it. I believe you can do it. I know you're doing it even as I pray. This is what people of faith do. It is who we are. We are people of prayer. And then last, supernatural activity occurred and supernatural peace happened. But then lastly, and this is my last thought, and that's this, supernatural stories were told. Peter just had this super giddy story. He's like, guess what happened? It was so awesome. And this thing happened, and this thing happened, and this over here, and you gotta tell everybody. I'm like, he's like freaking out with a story about all that God had done. Just asking this question, how many of you, when you remember to pray, have some sort of miracle story about how God answered? Can I see your hands? Just put your hands up. Okay, put them up, leave them up. Now I want you to look around the room. It is almost 100% of every person in this room right now has a miracle story of how God answered their prayer But what's the enemy trying to get you to do? Don't pray. Vent, get angry, organize, try something else. You know God does miracles, universal. Answers the prayer in this room. Stories are told. Don't you want to hear great stories of what God's going to do next? Don't you want to hear how God rescued this nation from destruction? Don't you want to hear about how marriages got restored, or how you thought your business was going over the cliff and all of a sudden God just restored it and you have no way to explain it except for it was automated. It was supernatural. God just did it. That's what he wants to do for you. 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and will heal their land. You know what that verse basically says? He is ready and waiting to answer your prayer. He wants to answer you. He wants to come through for you. He loves you so much. So we are ending this service different than usual. Let me invite you to stand to your feet. We're gonna dismiss you starting on this side of the room over here. And we're gonna ask you, as they dismiss those rows on that side, you can go ahead and start, to go outside and then find two or three other people before you go to your car and pray. We just want you to find somebody. What? I actually have to, you can do it. Why? Because God's waiting for you. So as you exit today, rather than just going out to your cars and driving away, we're not gonna do that final blessing slide like we would usually do. In fact, the end of the service is outside on that little pad out front. And we want you to take a minute and we need to find somebody else and we want you to pray with them. We want you to pray three prayers. God, help our country. God, help our families. God, help our church. God, help our country. God, help our families. God, help our church. As you leave, let's not just study prayer. Let's try it, church, and see what God might do. As you're going, I'm gonna pray for you. And you just find some, if you can't find anybody else out there to pray, I'll be out there, Pastor Kelly will be out there, Lynn's gonna be out there. Like I know there are several people that Pastor Ruben and Susie will be out there. Like just find somebody else that's one of our other, we'll pray with you, we'll happily pray with you. But don't just leave. Get together and pray with somebody else. Lord Jesus, we believe you answer prayers. We believe that you do miracles today. We believe you move and you transform. And we ask you to start with us. May you raise up a church that prays. May we run to you before everything else. And may you transform us. May you transform our country. May you heal it. May you heal our marriages and our families. May you protect our businesses and our workplaces. And Lord, may you grow your church and advance it against the gates of hell. In the middle of all of our crisis, may you prevail like you prevailed with Peter. May you prevail with us. We believe you are the great God of transformation. Do it for us. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.